Hi students, welcome to the course on cyber security. Myself, Dr. A. Murli Rao, head of IT department, Indira Gandhi National Open University, New Delhi. This session, I would like to talk on hackers, attacks, and countermeasures. Before to talk on hackers, I would like to talk on first the digital infrastructure. Let's see that what is the digital infrastructure. Digital infrastructure, which is deployed at the network domain, the security domain, system level, application level, and data level. See, the infrastructure deployed at network domain are the routers, the switches, and so on and so forth. Similarly, at security domain, the devices are firewall, intrusion detection systems, intrusion prevention systems, antivirus, and so on and so forth. Similarly, at system domain, the infrastructure is like servers, the systems, desktop computers, laptops, smart mobile devices, and so on. And at application level, the digital infrastructure, which we call it as the software applications, services, debit or credit card, passwords, and etc. And at data level, the digital infra, again we talk, is as a database, storage, repository. See, why digital infra requires security? The digital infra requires security to protect the devices deployed at the network, the system, the application, the data or database domains from hackers and attackers. To ensure high availability of systems and services, ensure business continuity, secure data and data transmission. See, what is a security breach? A security breach is any incident that results in unauthorized access of data, applications, services, networks, and or devices by bypassing their underlying security mechanisms. A security breach occurs when an individual or an application illegitimately enters a private, confidential, or unauthorized logical IT perimeter. A security breach is also known as a security violation. How do we know that there will be a security breach? It is a big question that even for a system administrators to know that how there is a security breach. See, violation in any of the following security parameters leads to security breach. One is the authentication, confidentiality, integrity, authorization, access control, and non-repudiation. See, violation of any of these parameters leads to there will be a security breach. What will happen if there is a security breach? If there is a security breach, hackers will take an advantage of it to intrude into organization's network, get access to services, servers, systems, applications, and databases, steal and or delete the sensitive data for sake of fun or business discontinuity or business loss, deface websites, web portals, inject viruses, trojans, and many more to damage. So that's why when there will be a security breach, the hackers will take advantage to do all these things. In so, then who will be or who is the culprit to do so? For that, we call a person who is doing all such things, we call it as a hacker. Hacker means a person or a device gain unauthorized access to the digital resources. Here see that hacker need not be a person, even a device, even a some script, even a some software. So in any form which will do some damage to the digital infrastructure, we can call it as a hacker. So in such case, a hacker is a person or a device gain unauthorized access to the digital resources. A person who is either internal or external to the organization. So hacker mostly internal or maybe external too. See the reports, if you see the statistics or the report says that most of the attacks or security breaches are being done by the internal staff of the organization. Why? It means that the internal staff knows the everything about from the network level to up to data level. Say what type of access control list we have, that what type of systems, what ports are open, what ports are closed, what are the applications, what is the data, what is the security policy, everything mostly the internal people know. That's why the report says that most of the attacks being done by the internal staff. In some time, even the report says that even more than 75% of attacks being done by internal staff. And of course, there are external people also there. We call it as the external people who can also do some this kind of hacking or attacks. How do we classify a hacker? See, hacker, depending on his nature, we can see that we can classify a hacker as a white hat or a black hat. These are all some technical terms for the name given to the hacker. So, white hat means that he is a ethical hacker. Generally, ethical hacker means that who is allowed. It means that, for example, see that in any organization, once we have configured, commissioned some network setup or some IT setup to check that how good it is securely. So, for that a person can see that how strong the security deployed at the network, the system, the application, the data. So, in such case we call a person who doing that, we call it as a penetration testing. So, a person who is allowed to do such thing, that's why we call him as ethical hacker. He is a computer security specialist who breaks into protected system and network to test and assess their security. And the white hat use their skills to improve security by exposing vulnerabilities but not to do any damage. Even not only ethical hacker, not only for a penetration testing to check how good the an institutional or an organizational network or a IT setup is there. Even though somebody else also, just for a fun purpose, just to intrude into the someone's organization network and to do all this thing, but they cannot do any damage. But whereas the second type of hacker, we call it him as a call him or her as a black hat, is a hacker who has the malified intention and violates security for a personal gain. So we means that the organizations afraid about the black hat who does damage to the institutional network, damage to the institutional system services, damage to the data. It means that the black hat always has a malified intention to disturb the network, to disturb the system, even to damage, to destruct even the business continuity of an institutional IT setup. Next one is that, see, hacker, when we talk about hacking, so let's see, I would like to stress upon the threat landscape. In a nutshell and in an abstract way, the threat landscape is, one is software based, hardware based and people. Software based means that could be a viruses, could be a worms, could be a spyware, could be a rootkits, exploit scripts, protocols exploitation and so on. These are all comes under a software based threats. And similarly, hardware based threats also there. So, hardware trojans and the fake components and so on. And the third is that people, again it is through an insider or outsider threats. This is the total threat landscape based on any of these three or all of these three, or sometimes one, sometimes combination of hardware, software based. See, some attack vectors, means that where the hackers use the some kind of platform, where use a place through which they start the hacking or attack. See, one is that human element, the other is web browsers, through internet exposed assets, through exploitation of vulnerabilities or misconfigurations or misconfigured setup, network propagation, data leakage, mobile app stores, malicious USB drives and card skimmers. Probably there are many more attack vectors also, but these are all the commonly used attack vectors by the hackers. Human element means that use the human, like a more or less like a social engineering kind of thing. Through that also attack, that is a place where to start attack the environment. Again, there are web browsers also. See, that's why what I would like to say is that while choosing the web browser also, we have to choose that the secure and standard web browser. And see, the web browsers also means that is again a some place where hackers do some kind of hacking or attacks through web browsers. And see, the internet exposed assets and exploitation of vulnerabilities or misconfiguration and setup. It means that once we setup is properly configured and commissioned and deployed, but that is if we are not done properly, that is also the hackers will take advantage by exploiting of the vulnerabilities available at the configuration files and setup files. And again, of course, the network propagation. See, network should be always controlled, not open. And again, also the data leakage. It means that see that nowadays, because of interoperability of various electronic devices. So, for example, take say a memory stick or a pen drive, which is frequently copying from the data or information or a audio or a video from one device and copying into other and so on and so forth. Because of that also the data leakage is happening. Through that also the hackers take advantage again to do or to intrude into the institutional network. And similarly, nowadays the mobile app stores, which is also one of the major attack vectors. See, generally we see that any mobile app available, it doesn't mean that which is of genuine. Even nowadays, so millions of mobile apps are available at mobile stores, even like the Google Play Store and so on. So this also, that's why before choosing even a particular mobile app, one has to properly assess it. So because of this, see, mobile app stores is also one of the attack vectors through which the hackers will take advantage to intrude into the organization network. And similarly, the malicious USB drives and also card skimmers. Mainly the card skimmers are also a place where to capture the financial data. See, for example, if you use a credit card or debit card for any online banking or online business or online shopping. So these card skimmers, once we insert into even when we insert it, the card skimmers again collect the sensitive information and to start misusing of this. So these are all some of the attack vectors through which the hackers will take advantage to start their initiation to intrude into the organization network. Once they intrude into the organization network, automatically they can intrude into the systems, the applications, the data and so on and so forth to damage the digital resources. See, for example, say a few domain wise attacks. Just I classified that some attacks domain wise. As I told you that there is a organizational IT setup, if you talk that, there are different levels. One we call it as a network level, system level, application level, data or database level. See, for example, the beginning level, that is a at gateway or institutional gateway, we call it as a network level. At network level, some of the attack, I hope nowadays there are so many attacks are there, but some, just for understanding purpose, just I am placing before you that some attacks domain wise. At network level, denial of service, which simply in a short form, it is DDoS attack. And even DDoS also, that is called distributed denial of service attack, which is very, very commonly used attack at network level. See, for example, see, denial of service means that it means that there is some type of attack through, because of this, a genuine user not able to access the institutional digital resources. So it means that the hacker maximum consume the network traffic or consume the resources of a servers, and through which the genuine users not able to perform their activities. It's not a damage, but the thing is that it will occupying or consuming maximum resources, whether it's a network, whether it's a system or application level. The hackers will try to pump or try to send huge amount of packets without any outcome, just so that to make their main purpose of DDoS, distributed DDoS or maybe DDoS attack, is that to consume the maximum resources of the network and system, so that the genuine users cannot perform their actual work or actual activities. Similarly, IP spoofing. So IP spoofing means that suppose a system, for example, is distinctly identified through a internet protocol, or we call it as a IP address. So again, by spoofing that, again the system may not be made accessible. Similarly, the man in middle, it means that once some activities going on from source to the destination, it means that from end user to the server, the man in middle attack means that because there are so many transit nodes, we call it as a network hub, through some place where the network traffic can be listened, even because of this man in middle attack, even some additional traffic can be included. It means that some additional stuff can be embedded or something may be deleted. So many things are possible with man in middle attack. These are all, of course, there are many also there, teardrop and so many other attacks also there. But just for a discussion sake, I put forward to you that these are all some of the attacks being done at network level. Similarly, some attacks at system domain or a system level. One is that the password file theft or password file modification or deletion. See, as far as if you are talking about a server, system or a server, it means that if a password file means that the all users, genuine users data is in a password file. That is, if that data is captured, if that is modified, that is if they deleted, then totally it is a major chaotic situation. That's why the hackers play a role in thefting the password file or modifying some of the entries of a password file, even to delete some of the entries or maybe the entire file. Similarly, port sweeping. See, at system level, depending on the services, depending on the applications, ports to be open, ports to be closed means to regulate the traffic. So again, port sweeping is also one of the attacks at a system level. Another is the privileges escalation. This is also another most dangerous type of attack. See, for example, there are, you know, in a system, there are different users are there, and people have a different role. Say, for example, a supervisor, or suppose a system administrator, who has all the root privileges. Root privileges means that the system administrator who has generally root privilege, so that he or she can do any part, any level, anything in a system. And there are some end users are there. So those people only restricted to use of certain functionalities of the system or application, not anything. So that's why, so the privilege escalation is also one of the dangerous thing or some kind of attack where hackers will create some ordinary account, but escalate that account or ordinary account privileges to higher level, like as equal to the root level. Once an ordinary user account is escalated to say a root level, so that through that account, again, whatever a system administrator, generally system administrator means that he is the owner of the system or owner of a computer or owner of the server, means that who has overall control, overall access on all digital resources of the system. So the privilege escalation is also one of the major attacks being performed by hackers at system level. Another is also Trojan horse, is also one type of attack where some malicious content or maybe command or maybe scripts will be dumped into a system, and whenever the server system starts rebooting, those Trojan, those malified scripts will be executed, and that script is mostly for to damage the digital resources or resources of the system. Even a Trojan horse, so far we listened that, we heard that Trojan horse is a software based attack. Now it is a dangerous thing is that even hardware Trojans also came. The difference between software Trojan and hardware Trojan. Software Trojan means that again it is a piece of a malified code which will distract or damage the digital resources. But you know, hardware Trojan means that now again it is a malified what we call that at chip level. So a malified code will be embedded to defunct the digital device, could be a computer, could be a TV, could be any electronic device. If the hardware Trojan is embedded at chip level, then the device will start malfunction after certain period. See, maybe now today or in a near future, it is going to be a big threat to the electronic industry due to this hardware Trojans. Anyway, maybe in some other session I will touch more on the hardware Trojans. Of course, these are all some of the threats being performed by a hacker at system level. Similarly, at application level. Yeah, at application level, there are again so many violations or hacking attacks will be done. One is that, say, session hijacking, cross-site scripting, broken authentication, injection flaws, sensitive data exposure, and these are all some of the vulnerabilities or some of the attacks done by hackers at application level, that is web application. Now next one is that then data or database level. At this stage, the hackers will connect to the data or database for what purpose? So for data theft or data modification or data deletion or the other type of activities. So these are all some of the domain wise attacks. Once again, I'm just repeating that some of the domain wise attacks are some attacks at network level, at system level, at application level, and database level. Now what are security challenges? Maintaining security posture with changing business model and attack vectors, and continuously protecting across a dynamic threat landscape, reducing complexity and fragmentation of security solutions. So these are all really a security challenges to protect the digital infrastructure from hackers or attackers. So how do we protect digital infrastructure? We can protect the digital infrastructure by deploying security devices and enforcing access controls. At again, what I told you that how the attackers do perform attacks on various domains. Similarly, so to protect digital infrastructure, again we have to keep it in mind that the infrastructure deployed at all the domains should be protected. See, for example, at network level, to protect the network level digital infrastructure like a router, switches and so on, for that we need apart from enforcing access control list, so we need to deploy a firewall, maybe intrusion detection system, intrusion prevention system, antivirus, and maybe many more also. Even nowadays UTM is also coming, unified threat management is also a device. So these are all some of the devices to be deployed at network domain to protect the digital infrastructure deployed at network. Similarly, to protect the system domain, what we had to do that? The first thing is that we had to hardening the operating system and also put a strong password. So hardening the operating system means that, see, for example, to remove all unnecessary default user accounts and see that if any directories which have the more privileges which should not be required, that to be done, and see that any unauthorized accounts will be there, those to be removed. So mainly the hardening the operating system means that, see, if there is any unnecessary ports are opened or not. See, for example, a server is being configured only for a emailing purpose. For that, other than the sending and receiving the email, like a port 25 and port 110, other than these two ports, no need of any other ports should be opened in that server. So that's why a hardening of the operating system means that by seeing that what purpose that system is commissioned, so only such ports only to be allowed for receiving and sending the traffic, all other things can be closed. So that is also part of hardening the operating system, means hardening the system. Similarly, put a strong passwords and so many such things to be done, which to be done at system level. And again, when comes to the application level, so for that, writing a secure code, we call it as a defensive programming, as part of software for a service. Anyway, one more session exclusively on defensive programming. But anyway, when we talk about the application protecting digital infrastructure at application level, compulsory it requires secure code or secure programming is needed, and also use digital signatures and also one-time passwords for non-repudiation and more authentication. Even we can introduce multi-level authentication also. These are all some of the things can be done to protect the digital infra at application level. Similarly, data or database level. So enforcing encryption during data transfer from source to destination, and also at database and at least on sensitive data. See, for example, nowadays in a web environment, always servers are at one end and users are scattered across. While performing any activity, even for example, take in a student and institution scenario, or university and student. So the university infrastructure, for example, deployed at the institution premises, but students are remote to the institution. Suppose if they are, for example, applying for a admission online, where the student will submit all his credentials, sensitive information, even for payment of a fee, again through payment gateway. For that, again a credit card or debit card details also will be provided. But what here to be done is that while data transmission, so no data should be transferred or transmitted in a plain text. That's why always it is to be encrypted. These are all some of the things can be taken up at a data or a database layer. Even for example, it is difficult also to encrypt the entire data in database, but at least you can distinguish that some confidential data, some sensitive data like say some financial related thing or say marks, wherever when such things are there, better such sensitive data should be encrypted, not only in data transmission stage, even at storage stage. And another is that controlled access and use of network systems and services. So compulsory controlled access and controlled usage is required in on system which are in a networked environment. So what do we need? For that, a strong digital infrastructure security policy is required. System and services should always pass through security audit before deployment or in a real time. See, for example, once a web application is developed, we should not just host just like that in a real time for the public. What I would like to suggest here is that whatever application we design, developed, it should be tested and also security audit to be done. Security audit means that the auditors will audit the entire code and see that is there any vulnerabilities in that code. So that's why once it passed through security audit, whatever violations are there, whatever loopholes are there, those loopholes will be identified and then will be closed, all the such loopholes, so that the web application would be as robust as possible to avoid the chance or scope to the hackers or attackers to intrude into the application. So the system should be captured all events happening or happened and stored in form of a log file for monitoring and to do postmortem in case of damage happened. See, what I would like to say here is that some log to be maintained for each and every activity being happening in a system. So that what will happen is that whenever something happened, not only something, even for a proactive or reactive measures, always whatever the server is responding, so all such events, all such activities should be captured in form of a log file, so that it helps for monitoring and also it helps to postmortem what happened if something is happened. Always the log file should be maintained. And similarly, regular system and data backup required to restore the system or services in case of damage happened. See, for example, because once a system is networked, working in a network environment, it means that always it is prone to hack or attack. It doesn't mean that everything happened, but always there is a hack, attacks or hacking possibility will be there. See, for example, in such case, I will quote in a general way that, so once any electronic device, any device connected to net, it means that always prone to hack or attack, but it doesn't mean that every time it will hack or attack. It is similarly like an automobile, driving a car on a highway. It means that always there is a prone to accident, but it doesn't mean that so once we are driving a vehicle or a car on highway means that every time accident happens, but there is a chance there is a prone to accident. Similarly, at any device, any server, any computer connected to the net means that always it will prone to hack or attack. Even though, for example, even the device is connected but not in use, generally most of us feels that okay, I am not using so that nothing will happen. It is not like that. Even though once a device is connected to net, even though whether it is even in a idle stage also, always there is a chance for a hacker attack. Similarly, like it is in general just like parking a car on a highway, it means that always the highway is always prone to accident. So whether it is running, whether it is idle, but once it is connected, always scope are prone to hack. So that's why further what will happen, what we have to do, that regular system and data backup to be taken, so that even in worst case some hacking or some attack happened, that so we can restore the systems and services with no time or with a minimum time to restore back and for a business continuity. And also one more is that redundancy in form of compulsory, because by keeping importance of the application in mind, redundancy level should be sometimes so 100% redundancy, sometimes 99%, sometimes 90%, depending on the type of application or the type of sensitivity of the business. So in such case, redundancy is to be ensured in form of internet connectivity. It means that more than one internet service provider, so that whatever the reason one ISP is down, at least the services will be provided through another ISP. So it means that redundancy required at internet connectivity, and redundancy required even at system and servers. It means that even though, for example, say, even if you have a multiple systems running on a load sharing basis, even though for whatever reason some system is gone bad or attacked, at least through other system the services or the business can be continued or ensured. And similarly, redundancy required for applications and services and database and storage. It means that always, depending on the sensitivity of the business application, always redundancy is needed. See, for example, Gmail. See, to the best of my knowledge, I have been using the Gmail services since last more than 15 years. But I never found that the Gmail service was down. It means that always the service availability is almost more than 99.9999%. It means that probably the devices, the mobile, Gmail, some servers also might be down sometime, but because of redundancy, the users not found that the Gmail is down. Like that, what I would like to say here is that by keeping sensitivity of the business in mind, redundancy level to be established, either 100% redundancy or 90%, 75%, like that we have to look into. Now, best practices to be followed for a network gateway and systems. So deploy system security devices, as I told you that maybe a firewall is required, even because of the sensitivity of because the hackers are more intelligent, becoming more smart, compulsory no single secure device is supporting. That's why so secure devices can be deployed like a firewall level, firewall or IDS, IPS like intrusion detection system or intrusion prevention system, even a UTM, so unified threat management and antivirus. These are all some of the secure devices to be deployed at network level, so that to protect our network. It means that each device has certain predefined functionalities, so that so any outside network or inside network, like inbound and outbound traffic will be controlled, will be defined and determined, and enforce access control list, we call it as ACL. Means that because the hackers or attacks are very dynamic in nature, one type of access control lists are not sufficient. So in a proactive manner, even a reactive manner, access control list should be time to time to be enforced. That's why enforce access control list time to time, and use standard operating system and hardening it, and enforce multi-level authentication for sensitive applications. These are all some of the best practices to be followed or to be deployed or to be enforced at network gateway and also system level to protect the network, to protect the systems from hackers or attackers. And even still, if you can, so some more best practices to be followed at end user level. end user level. So use strong password to all digital devices like such as computers, laptops, mobile phone, tablets and so on, and also change frequently the passwords. So always strong passwords are always required. The strong password means that at least minimum put 8 characters in length. The 8 also put a mixing of characters such as some alphabetic, even alphabets also, some uppercase, some lowercase, some special characters like a dollar symbol, exclamatory, or a bracket, all comma, like that. So we have to put some combination of alphabets, digits and special characters, and minimum characters as not less than 8 characters, so that always the password will be, the system will be protected with password. That's why always strong password should be enforced. And deploy security devices, that is a firewall, IDS, UTM also, and enforce access control, even not only at a system level or a server level, even at end user digital infrastructure also, these are required. And again, always use antivirus and update antivirus time to time. And use standard OS, don't use for any pirated software, especially for operating system. Don't use a standard operating system and update its patches time to time. And controlled use of debit credit card for e-commerce, and do not disclose PIN numbers. See, nowadays maximum the digital transactions are increasing day by day, even exponentially. But even though we had to have a control, user should have a control in usage of debit or credit card, because especially the financial transactions, which is a more and more so insecure and sensitive, that's why one should have a control over use of debit and credit card for e-commerce. And see, once these credentials are compromised, so lot of the financial loss. And apply always bare minimum financial limits at our internet banking account, and change on demand only. And smart devices are more vulnerable, which disclose your identity, so use minimum as possible. Even though, for example, if you are using internet banking account, always put that the financial limits as less as possible. Whenever you need, you can put that. What will happen is, even though your internet banking account is compromised, but because of the limited limits, so that damage also can be controlled. Whenever we want, we can escalate or increase the limits. Similarly, smart devices also better, because they will always disclose our identity, so that use as minimum as possible. And the conclusion is that digital infra security is always a continuous process, but not a one-time activity. Security is a process-based, but not product-based. So it means that since hackers or attackers always paying attention, because of nowadays the digital transactions are increasing exponentially, whether the financial transactions, non-financial transactions. So that's why it is a high time to secure the digital infrastructure. So for that, always the security of a digital infrastructure is a continuous process, but not a one-time activity. It means that just deploying the security devices such as a firewall or IDS, IPS or antivirus, even though some extent these are fine, but it is not a one time. So we have to continuously see that what new things are coming, that then how to protect by enforcing more access control is time to time. That's why security can be treated as a process based, but not process product based. So the message for this is that the controlled and conscious digital access and usage leads life comfortable, because since in a digital era where most of digital transactions are happening at maximum extent, so that automatically the hackers also playing a vital role. So that's why always prevention is better than cure in a nutshell. That's why the message for this the talk or the session is that control and conscious digital access and usage leads life of a person comfortable. Thank you.